You're listening to the audio production of Supernatural Power for Everyday People, Experiencing God's Extraordinary Spirit in Your Life by Jared C. Wilson, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Stephen Roy Grimsley.
Introduction. Meet Bill. Bill is 28 years old and lives in a condominium in a typical middle-class suburb of a mid-sized city. He gets up at 5:30 every morning, shaves, showers, dresses, and eats breakfast. If he has time, he watches some cable news or surfs the web. 45 minutes after waking, Bill pours some coffee in a to-go cup and leaves for work. Bill's commute takes him an hour, sometimes a little more. He tried carpooling once, but he found the carpoolers unreliable, and he knows that if he doesn't leave by 6:15 or so, the traffic will be much thicker and the commute much more frustrating. Arriving at work around 7:15 on a good day with no delays, Bill immediately heads to his cubicle. His co-workers are either too busy working or too busy waking up, so nobody gives anybody else much more than a polite nod. Bill spends 4 hours pushing numbers around spreadsheets and responding to emails. At lunchtime, he walks down to the corner fast food joint, gets a value meal to go, returns to his cubicle, and eats at his desk while surfing news sites and watching YouTube. When lunch is over, Bill spends another 4 to 5 hours pushing numbers around and responding to emails. He takes a few breaks, using the restroom, getting a soda out of the machine in the break room, and playing games on Facebook. Every now and then, someone will stop by his cubicle to say hey or chit-chat about sports or ask about reports that are due or were due. At 5:15 p.m., Bill walks out to the parking garage. Some of his co-workers have already left, and the ones who remain are too busy trying to get ready to go home, so nobody holds anybody up. He gets in his car and begins the drive home, which takes longer than the morning commute. Bill enters his neighborhood at 6:30 p.m., drives to the parking lot of his condo, takes his assigned space, and walks to his front door. He enters the house and turns on the TV. He is too tired to worry about dinner for the moment. At 8 p.m., he gets hungry, forages for a can of soup, gets it simmering, and makes a sandwich. He goes to bed at 11, making sure his alarm is set for 5:30 a.m. When the morning comes, he does the same routine all over again. On Saturdays, Bill sometimes goes out, but he mostly stays in and watches movies, plays video games, noodles around on his guitar, and chats with friends on the internet. On Sunday morning, Bill goes to church, where he is greeted at the door, but then talks to no one else. He sits in the same place every week, sings along to the music, usually enjoys the sermon, and goes home immediately after the closing prayer so he doesn't miss the start of the football game. This is Bill. His life isn't really the kind people write books about, which make him totally normal. And yet, here I am writing a book about people like Bill. Why? Because if there is one thing ordinary people like Bill, and like you and me, need, it's more reminders of just how extraordinary our lives really are. Does your routine sound a little like Bill's? Maybe it is not as boring or predictable, but it might be just as lonely. Even if Bill were a little older and had a wife and school-aged children, his interaction with them would still be limited because of his daily schedule, and his interaction with those outside his family would be more limited still. But something happens to Bill. Maybe it's happened to you, too. Maybe it's the reason you picked up this book. One Saturday night, Bill finds himself unable to get to sleep. Nothing works. Not tea, not mindless television, not reading, not white noise. They all just remind him of his routine, which reminds him of his routine life, the emptiness of which is what is finally and acutely bothering him. It's not job stress or relationship fears bothering him at the moment. It's something more vague, more general, and yet somehow keener. A nagging sense of dissatisfaction is keeping Bill awake. He feels as though there must be something more to life, but he's not sure what that could be. He thinks about volunteering at a local homeless shelter, but he isn't sure he has the time. He considers giving more money to charity, but he's not sure he can afford it. And he's not sure he should try to afford it until he pays off all his credit card debt. Every solution Bill thinks of doesn't quite fit the problem that he can't quite define. It dawns on Bill that his problem may not exactly be something that can be solved by working harder or adding more to his schedule. When Sunday morning comes, he decides to go to church early and attend a Sunday school class. He sets uneasily through a lesson on Jonah, and when the time comes to share prayer requests, he can hardly contain himself. "I know you don't know me very well," he says to the people who don't know him at all. "And I know that I'm a Christian, but I keep feeling like something's missing in my life. I feel like there should be more. I feel lonely. But that's not really the problem. I feel bored. But that's not really the problem. I feel..." Bill trails off, trying to think of the right word. Finally, he simply says, "I feel confused." This is the most Bill has said to anyone in quite a while. And the response from the class isn't very pronounced. A few people nod. A few more shift uneasily in their seats. Bill has broken customary church class protocol, which is mainly oriented around everybody pretending to be fine. The Sunday school teacher politely says, "Thanks for sharing. Would anyone mind praying for Bill?" A single woman named Carrie agrees to pray for Bill. And in just a few short lines, she asks that God would give Bill peace, comfort, wisdom, and a sense of God's own divine presence. Not much happens. Bill wasn't quite sure what to ask for, and nobody was quite sure what to pray for. The class quickly moves on to the next prayer request, and afterward, Bill walks to the auditorium for the worship service. But now, something different happens. He sings the songs a little louder. He listens a little more intently to the sermon. When it's over, his drive home feels less lonely. Nobody gave him any religious homework. Nobody even gave him an answer. But for some reason, he feels suddenly more joyful. Bill has experienced something new, something fresh from the Spirit of God. It makes him feel a certain way, sure, but it's not simply about feelings. What he feels is really more of an assurance, a reassurance, that he is rooted to something deeper than his feelings, something bigger than the earthly agendas and ambitions of his everyday life. He was not able to put it this way at the time, but what he experienced was actually what the Apostle Paul talked about in Romans chapter 8, verse 16. The Holy Spirit of God testifying to his own spirit that he belonged to the Father. And this is just the tip of the spiritual iceberg. Every Christian is vitally connected to the person and work of the Spirit of the living God. And we experience this connection in a variety of ways, ways that are reflective of the Spirit's divine nature and power. I am firmly convinced that too many Christians spend most of their lives trying to carry out their everyday routines in their own strength. The Bible has lots of warnings about this precisely because it's such a common tendency. It just comes naturally to us. But followers of Jesus Christ have someone supernatural living right inside their very spirits. Anyone who has repented of sin and exercised faith in Jesus, in fact, has done so because of the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. And this power takes up residence in our lives for all eternity. God has set up shop, as it were, in our hearts. Discovering this extraordinary, life-changing reality is what this book is all about. I've known lots of Bills throughout my time in church communities. Heck, more than a few times, I've been Bill. One day I feel numb to my routine like a zombie on a treadmill, just going through the required motions, wondering if anything I'm doing matters or is amounting to anything. Then for some reason, I can't quite put my finger on, I have a bit more oomph. My routine didn't change, but my vision seems a little clearer, my steps firmer, my future brighter, even if still unknown. You could chalk this up to some kind of mood swing or the rise and fall of one's seasonal affective disorder. In Bill's case, you could argue that just being able to talk to somebody helped lift his mood. There is no doubt these are important factors in the complex dispositions of human nature, but for the Christian, there is something else. There is, in fact, someone else. In my capacity as a pastor, I have had many conversations with people walking weary miles in Bill's worn shoes. In the early years of my ministry, I would have tried every kind of pep talk I could think of to cheer them up. But as time went on and I gathered more experience, and by God's grace more wisdom, I came to believe that most Christians struggling with purpose and vision and boredom and powerlessness didn't really need more things to do or better catchphrases on which to hang their hopes. What they needed was a peek behind the curtain to the reality of their inner lives. Chapter 1. The Problem with Your Inner Life. Experiencing the Spirit's Conviction. Apart from God's power, there is no Christian life. This crucial truth makes the phrase Christian life in the power of the Spirit essentially redundant. The Holy Spirit causes the process that Jesus referred to as being born again, and the Holy Spirit seals those who are born again to ensure they stand blameless before God at the end of their days, and the Holy Spirit sustains those who are born again every millisecond between those two moments. Because of this, if a person lived apart from the power of the Holy Spirit, he would not be a Christian. In fact, he could not even be said to be spiritually alive at all. But many of us, Christians included, don't think of God's power this way. We experience an especially powerful church service and say things like, God showed up. We muddle through an extended period of spiritual drought and say, God is hiding from me, or God is giving me the silent treatment right now. We read in some books or hear in some sermons that God really wants to bless us in some exceptional way if we would only let Him. All of these ways of thinking betray a fundamental misunderstanding of God's real presence in our daily lives. We need to understand that when our life feels lacking in power, it's not because we haven't actualized our innate potential. In fact, that's the problem. When our life is lacking in power, it's typically because we are working in our own strength too much. Similarly, when our life is lacking vision and we feel confused and bored, it's not because we are missing out on the power of positive thinking. It's precisely because we are leaning on our own understanding. When Christians live sluggish Christian lives, it's not because they don't have enough of God, but because they have too much of themselves. Because, in actuality, it is impossible for any true Christian not to have enough God. If you are a Christian, that is, if you are someone who has repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus Christ alone for salvation, God's presence in your life is guaranteed. His love is always over you. His Son in heaven is always interceding for you, and His Spirit has taken up residence in your soul to give you the power required for every need you have. This is God's honest truth. And yet too many of us live weak, pitiful Christian lives. We constantly feel spiritually dry, theologically confused, and religiously weary. Is there any hope for us? It's not as if we aren't looking for answers. It's just that we too often look for these answers in the wrong places. Or alternatively, when we incline our ear to reliable sources of truth, we misunderstand what they're saying. The first mistake we make is looking inside ourselves for the help we need. We won't find the solution in the place where the problem is. If we want to participate in the truly supernatural life in this earthly world, we have to stop looking for earthly solutions to our problems. The first step is realizing you don't have what it takes. Once upon a time, my friend Ray and I each planted a church. We planted our churches in the same year in the same place. In fact, the church I planted met on Sunday evenings in Ray's church building. On some Sunday mornings, some folks from my church would attend Ray's church. We really enjoyed Ray's preaching.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.